All right, how are you?
I am good. How are you? Nice to meet you
I'm
face to face on
yeah,
Skype.
thank you. Likewise, likewise. Okay. Sometimes I'll be looking at this camera here because I have had sessions on Skype where the audio failed, so I didn't have a backup, you know? So I have a backup just in case. Okay.
Can you hear me all right?
Yes. I can hear you all right.
Okay. Sometimes my internet gets sketchy. Don't have the best internet that there is in the available, but usually it's all right.
I understand, you know, like I was in Brazil, and in Brazil you pay for like I think they say 10 gigabytes or 10 megabytes, but you only get 3. And it's terrible for downloading movies, takes a whole day. That's terrible. And you
Yeah.
pay a lot of money, you know?
It's kind of ridiculous. It's definitely not as easy and accessible as it is in the US.
Yes, I understand. Let's go ahead and start talking about Flat Earth. I see you have a beautiful map on the back
Yes,
there.
we have twin maps.
Yes. I really enjoy this map. So, Veronica, right? Veronica.
Yes.
Okay. So, tell me about your Flat Earth experience. How did it all start to you?
So, how did I get into Flat Earth? I was scrolling through Facebook one day, and I bumped into a post from my husband's cousin. And probably like most people, you know, she says the Earth is flat and motionless. And I chuckled to myself a little bit. And I probably would have just kept scrolling, except for I saw that there was quite a lot of comments under this post. And I thought, well, there's a lot of action happening under here. I'm going to check it out. So I checked on the comment section of her post, and I could see that she was actually serious. And I started reading through the comments, and I thought, wow, I never imagined anybody in this day and age still thought the earth was flat. That's kind of funny.
Right.
And so she, you know, she kept arguing her point and said a few things. And I thought, okay, well, I don't like to just dismiss things without checking them out. So I told her, well, this is really interesting. It intrigues me. I never, you know, it never occurred to me that the earth might actually be flat and that there could be a dome over the earth. Although I forever try to figure out what, you know, Genesis 1 was explaining, what's the heck's the firmament, you know? But in about 2009, I believe, I had a conversation with my father-in-law, and you know, we somehow were talking about NASA going to the moon, and he told me, I do not believe what anybody says. I don't believe they sent anyone to the moon. You know, the Bible tells us that the moon is a light. And he says, and I was there watching the, you know, all the videos and everything that was playing when it was all happening. And to me, he said it looked like a bad quality movie. And he says it looked so fake to me when it was happening. I didn't believe it, and I still don't believe it to this day. I was really shocked with him. I thought, oh, I'm going to prove it to you. He's like, no, I bet you anything. They never went to the moon. They lied to everybody. And I thought, well, is this even possible? So I had investigated into that. And after about 6 months of checking it out, I came to the conclusion he was absolutely correct. So I didn't bump into Flat Earth until probably October or November of 2014. And so I had already come to the conclusion that NASA was a liar, and you know, they were liars and nothing that they could, you know, they said could be trusted. And so when I came across the flat earth, I thought, is it even possible that they were lying about that? That's wow. I don't know why I never thought of that before. I, you know, knew it was a hoax that they'd gone to the moon, but it never occurred to me that everything else they told us might be a lie too. And so I started investigating it, but at first I was like, okay, is it possible? And then after I thought about it a while, you know, it gets you. You kind of feel irked that anybody could actually believe that. And so the first 2 weeks of my investigating Flat Earth was actually just me going back to all the heliocentric teachings and memorizing and refreshing myself. I'm like, I know I can get into this, and I know I've heard all the reasoning and the proofs why it's a globe. So my first 2 weeks of that were going and watching all the NOVA videos on the on cosmology and visiting the NASA channel, even though they were liars. I checked out their pictures and what they were, you know, I was like, okay, so let's see what they're telling us at least. And then I checked into the Discovery Channel videos and anything that was to do with globe, right? And so when I felt that I was thoroughly armed with all the proofs that I needed to teach Flat Earthers a lesson or two, I very bravely invited myself to a couple of Flat Earth groups.
Wow.
I think the first group I joined was the official Flat Earth versus Spare Earth group or something. And I got in there, probably like everybody else, determined to teach Flat Earthers a lesson. And when I actually started listening to, you know, their comebacks and their answers, I thought, wow, these guys make more sense than the authorities, you know.
Right.
And so I had to rethink everything. And after a couple of months of that, and before the end of December of 2014, I had spoken to my husband about it too, and so we were searching together. And by the end of December 2014, we had decided that we were, you know, definitely thinking there was way more possibility of Earth being a flat stationary plane than a globe. And so in January of 2015, just a minute. Yeah, I think so. So we investigated it. We got into groups with on WhatsApp with family and just went at it, battling globe versus flat plane. And some of the conversations get, you know, brutal. It's kind of hard. You really hit some nerves in people and it incites anger. My husband went to work one morning, and he suggested it to a couple of his coworkers, and a couple of them laughed, but one of them, he just absolutely blew up and told my husband that he couldn't believe he was so ridiculous, retarded, every other thing he could think of saying, that how could he possibly even consider or say something so, you know, such nonsense. And my husband thought, wow, he's never brought up any topic that triggered people so fast as Flat Earth does. You know, most people will make jokes, you know, bring out your tinfoil hat, that kind of thing. But for some reason, we're so emotionally attached to the globe that it literally is, it's a religion. We believe in it so strongly, and and we don't even know why. That's the sad thing. We don't even realize, we don't really understand why we even believe that. And when we start, I feel like when we start getting into that and asking ourselves, why do I think this? What's the proof? You know, I never proved it to myself. I just believed to somebody that told me. And if you're sincere and you're, and truth is your goal instead of being right, I think everybody will come to the truth of Flat Earth.
Well, interesting you saying that, because like before 2015, I always questioned the flood, Noah's flood, okay? how could the Noah's flood happen on a globe? I mean, I researched it, I read about, I went over like Kent Hovind's videos and other videos like Answering Genesis. And I was never really satisfied with the answer. You know, how could a globe be filled with water? I mean, and I had never heard from Flat Earth at that time, you know? And now 2015, I was more interested in the politics in the US, you know? And the videos, Flat Earth videos was popping up, but I wasn't paying attention. I was laughing at them. And I was more interested in the politics of that year. But then, you know, I watched one video. I watched it like I was the Matt Boylan, the one that he was doing like a stand-up comedy, okay? And he was talking about the flat earth, and then I said, well, it makes sense. Because then, you know, the Bible verse, when Jesus comes back and everyone will see him, only makes sense in the flat earth. You know, it doesn't make sense in Nepal. So that was like automatically, you know, like I said, well, you know, that's how that's going to happen. So that's then I started to understand how the flood happened. It had to be flat. Otherwise, the bowl cannot be filled with water, you know? And you know, I have to admit that in my case, because I knew the Bible, that was what caught my attention right away. You know, okay, the Bible is right. But on the other hand, I visited NASA like two times in the U.S. I brought my kids there. And in Alabama, where my daughter was born, there is the Space Center, NASA Space Center in Huntsville, okay? And she took school trips there. So where I helped her to build a solar system, you know, I was so much into that, so much. And when we moved to Japan, I was still like, I ordered from NASA in the U.S., some cards about all the constellations, all the stars, the everything, you know. I told her, you have to memorize this stuff, you know. And I when I received that stuff by mail, I came to the conclusion the earth was flat. So, well, I just wasted my money in this stuff here, you know. And I literally threw it away. I put it in the trash, you know. And it's very interesting, okay, very interesting how it is. And that's why I'm having these conversations, you know, like how you realize and the impact around the people who are around you. And you told me your husband is with you all the, you know, that's very nice. My wife, not so much. Not that she doesn't care. She does. She believes. She told me. It's just like, you know, if you see flat earth, there's more like 80% are men and 20% are women, you know. It's not that, I think, that's why I'm trying to interview one man.
Is that about this, statistically speaking? I wasn't aware of that.
Most of the time, you see, you know, like the meetings.
I do have to correct my date, because you're mentioning moving to Japan. I'm like, no, we really got heavy duty into flat earth right before we moved to Hawaii, and that was in February of 2016. So what we were researching in 2014 was 2015 and 2014 was Freemasonry, Freemasons. That's what that was. So no, it was December of 2015 is when we became flat earthers.
Okay.
Yes. So yeah. Correct that. 2014, we were already into the Freemasonry. So when I started into flat earth also, I became very aware that most of NASA employees were actually Freemasons. And I thought, oh, dear.
Yeah.
So that really cinched it for me. And this is not because, I mean, I know there's a lot of, I want to clarify, I know there's a lot of good people that are into Freemasonry and good men that get in there and they don't realize what they're getting into. My husband was invited by some friends that were Freemasons to join. And I just told him I didn't feel good about it until we learned more about it. And so we started researching and trying to understand, and this was several years before, but anyway, we studied it for quite a few years, but by 2014, we had absolutely decided there was no way in heck he was ever going to join the Masons. But the thing is that most people, they get in there and it looks like it's just a good fraternity, and literally, we read a lot of the books written by Freemasons, and I have on digital file like over 300 books that are Freemason books, not something that somebody wrote against Freemasons, okay? These are books written by Freemasons. And majority of what they teach is true, you know, good stuff and helping people on the lower levels, on the lower levels. And it's not until they, you know, really rank up that they get more hooked in and more devoted and more stuck. They can't get out, really, without risking their life or their family's life or somebody else. And so they don't realize, but most of what they do and teach is good. But let's say 5% of it that is bad is so vile and so dark and so evil that...
And so powerful, too, because that's the highest rank.
Well, because they support each other. They support each other. It's a group of people helping people, and they don't, you know, it's all about helping their brothers and not dealing with outsiders, you know? Right. You don't give outsiders. It's like religions saying keep it in the faith. Only Freemasons try to claim that Freemasonry isn't a religion because they, you know, they accept any religion. You just have to believe in God. That's fine. They teach that everything is mostly true. And all religions probably do have portions of the truth in them, you know, portions of truth in them. That's why people can even, you know, resonate with them and join, is because certain things feel true to them about it. But what is bad is not something, it's something that they, once they reach that point where they learn it, they already have so much invested into being a Mason that they're not going to turn back. And then there are cases of people that have turned and tried to expose and go against them, and they have found them dead, or there's, you know, eyewitness stories of them being killed in specific ways. And those are the ways that are applicable to, you know, the oaths that they broke, because every time they up a level, they, you know, rank to the next level, they take certain oaths and covenants, and they vow that, you know, if they break their oaths at that point, they agree to be killed in a specific fashion. And so a lot of people have died in the fashions that they were, that they had promised to die if they were to, you know, expose.
I'm glad your husband decided not to join this.
Me too. Yes. Yeah. That's a whole different, rabbit hole, I guess you could call it.
It is.
But
it's connected to the globe,
in.
You know?
It's connected to the globe. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Interesting. Now, you know, I've been talking to many Americans who live outside the U.S. You know, there are about 40,000 Americans living here in Japan. Not military people. There are the military people in Okinawa. There are like 20 bases here in Japan, but civilians, people who decided to live in Japan, there are about 40,000 Americans living here. It's the third largest group, okay, of foreigners in Japan. Yeah, yeah. The first one are the Chinese, okay, about, I don't know, 700,000. And the Brazilians are the second, about 150,000, because there's a connection between Brazil and Japan, you know? If you go back in history, about 100 years ago, Brazil was the country who opened the doors for them to move to Brazil when the place was really bad here, you know? After the war, also the same thing. So, like, they are reciprocating, you know, like, okay, you can come back now.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, but there are a lot of Americans here, too. I kind of talked to them. You saw I talked to Bill a couple of weeks ago, and What's the American community there in Mexico? Tell me a little bit. Are you connected, you guys?
Well, there's Americans everywhere here. I live in the Yucatan Peninsula, and so it's one of the most famous vacation destinations in the world, right? People are everywhere, from Merida to Cancun to all the way down, you know, Chetumal, a whole along the coastline, the beaches. There's nothing like them. I lived in Hawaii, in Kauai, for a year and a half, and the beaches there can't compare to the beaches here. They just can't. The sand here is so beautiful. The beaches are so gorgeous, and because of the reef that extends almost along the whole coastline, there's only a couple of breaks in it where they can bring the ships through. Then it's really safe. You don't have, obviously, you can't surf here like you can in Hawaii because mm-hmm. of the reef that's out there. It blocks all the waves, but it makes for really calm, peaceful, beautiful, you know, water. And so it's attracted.
Have you met any flat earthers there?
I haven't come across any other flat earthers around here, but we'll probably change that.
Yeah, it can maybe. I've been trying to organize a meetup. We actually had one last year. And because here, everyone lives so far away, you know, from each other. Like Bill is in Tokyo, I have friends in Osaka, and then Nagoya City. So we are all far away from each other, you know. We try because
right Japan,
we have JAXA here, you know, so Japanese are very proud of their space program. It's right. Not easy to find flat earthers. Although things are changing now, I've seen some channels in Japanese. There are people opening their eyes, especially the Christians, you know, the Japanese who are Christians and they believe in the Bible, they are opening their right. eyes. And it's very interesting to see. And I'm actually, you know, I've been studying Buddhism a little bit. Not that I'm interested in, you know, becoming a Buddhist or anything like that. But they come to me, you know, like they knock it on my door. I see them right. every day. This is like a Buddhist country, you know, so I got to bump into them every day. You know, my students.
Oh,
or
it's
people
good
that,
to understand it. We studied it. We studied it as well, and a lot. You know, a lot of religions looked into a lot of religions, but it's
so
interesting.
I've been looking into Buddhism lately, and I'm amazed because you know Buddhists, they believe in a flat Earth. You know, like the theory or the teachings of Buddha. And so there is a conflict, and I asked the lady, the Japanese lady, I said, well, if your teachings teach this stuff, how come you believe it on a globe? And, you know, we've been arguing
right.
with each other, you know?
You just got to bring out the contradictions.
Exactly. So I am enjoying studying a little bit, learning, so I can find points, you know, and say, okay, this is what it says. You should, you know, believe that stuff. Why are you preaching your religion to me if you don't believe what it says, you know? So I've been studying a little bit.
Right.
Yeah. But most for learning, you know. So let me ask another question. My daughter was in the U.S. and I was really worried about her. You know, she was there for 3 months. And she was going to go to college. Now, Alabama, if you don't know, it's a rural state, you know. It used to be very safe, extremely safe. When I was there, I lived there, I worked there. Now, I still get the college newspaper, the online edition.
Right.
And, you know, they found some ladies there, young ladies, found some marks on their cars where human traffickers, they put some marks on the cars to identify when females drive along. That got me scared because things like that didn't happen, like I would say 10 years ago, 15 years
right.
ago. It didn't happen. I was very scared, you know. So I told her to come back, and she's here, and she wants to study nursing. And I'm really divided about sending her back to the U.S. because I'm scared. I'm really scared. Like, Christianity has decreased, and the evil weakness has been increasing a lot, you know?
Right.
I don't know what to do about it. I'm really scared about it. How about you and your children? You told me you have children.
Yes. I do. I have 12 children and 6 grandchildren. So I have 3 daughters. We had 12. We had 5 girls before we ever had a boy. So 3 of my oldest daughters are married, and we have another engaged. We're getting married in June. And then we have 5 sons and 2 more girls. We finished off with a girl, and we have 1 girl sandwiched in the middle of all the boys. So 7 girls, 5 boys. And yeah, it's kind of a scary world. And you think about everything that's around, and it's not the same world I grew up in at all.
It has changed so much in less than 10 years.
Yeah, but with the increase of information and the good that's available on the internet, there's just as much evil available, you know, in anybody's hands. It's so easy to find porn and just horrible things that can really be all-consuming for young children. That, yeah, it is worrisome. But
so your family is in Hawaii. Like relatives, Hawaii?
I have a daughter living there still, and my husband has a couple of cousins. Most of our family lives in throughout, you know, different parts of Mexico, and then I don't know. I was going to stay mostly in Arizona, but that's not true. My dad's family lives in Arizona, but my mom's family is, you know, Utah, North Dakota, Alaska, California, Minnesota, Florida. I mean, they're all over the place. So,
okay.
And then so my husband's family's all over the place too. So I can't say we're any one place. We're spread out really well everywhere.
It is. I see.
I have a brother in Texas and another one in Utah and one in Mexico. And it's, yeah, I just nieces and nephews everywhere. And
okay. So most of your children with you?
We still have 9 children home. One is getting ready. One of our other daughters, the oldest, is getting ready to go back to Hawaii and live with my oldest daughter and get a job and stuff there. That's what she wants to do. So she's, you know, 22. You got to let them do what they want to do and what they feel like they're inspired and guided to do. And the thing is that I feel is this, we can't live in fear. It's really important not to live in fear. Bad things can happen, but ultimately I believe that, you know, one person power, whatever you want to call God, the creator, he gave us life and he will take it when it's our time to go. That's my belief. Yes, he allows bad things to happen to people, but I don't believe that anybody will die before it's, you know, God allows them to. Because you hear miraculous stories about people surviving the most horrendous, terrible crashes, you know, vehicles being crushed and the driver gets out of the vehicle with a few cuts and scrapes, you know, no serious injuries. And so I just think that if God doesn't want us to go, it's not going to be our time to go. He's going to keep us around. Yeah. And I do feel like for our children, it's important to teach them to make the right choices, but it's still their choices. You know, they still have to live their life. And I feel like God allows us to choose And we got to allow our children to choose as well. And that doesn't mean we have to condone or accept everything that they do. I don't feel like, but you know, you love them and you support them and you try to help guide them. And ultimately, we all have to decide what we believe in for ourselves. We can't, you know, we can't hang on to the beliefs of anyone. I certainly couldn't, you know, with my parents. My father's absolutely dead set against flat earth and and thinks I'm nuts. But my mom, my mom is the only flat earther that I know of that I've converted to flat earth.
Wow.
So, but they've been divorced for 35 years. They're not on the same page.
Yeah.
My dad is definitely a big science lover. His idea of teaching us Sunday school is to sit us up and watch. I sit us in front of the TV and let's watch this Star Wars. Let's do a Star Wars marathon and, you know, from beginning to end, watch all three. Wow. And then talk about the dark side and the light side and the good and the evil aspects of it. And he loved Star Trek and everything to do with, you know, NASA. It's really interesting because he was a boy when, you know, they sent man to the moon, supposedly, right? And before, a lot of people probably don't know this, but before they ever did that, several years before, sometime in the 50s, I think my dad said he was about six. So I don't know exactly what the time period was. When did they send, what year did they send man to the moon, supposedly?
1969.
In 69. Okay, right. So yeah, I think my dad was around 6 or 8 years old is what he said. And this was long before Flat Earth, he told me this story. But NASA sent out and advertised and asked artists from around the United States to send them pictures, paintings of what they thought would, what they thought that a walk, you know, what walking on the moon would be like, or what man would see when he got to the moon, that kind of a thing. So according to my dad, him and his older brother, 5 years older than him, decided to enter my grandma into the contest without her knowing. And she was a very talented artist, but they let her know afterwards that they had entered her into the contest for this painting, and there was some kind of award. I don't remember how much money or what it was, but recognition for sure, some kind of a certificate of recognition. But she actually received the award from NASA, and they got her painting and they featured it. She wrote a poem called A Walk in Space or something like that. And so she painted the moon and what she thought it would look like, and it was submitted. They sent it in, and she won the prize for it. And I think this is really interesting, is that NASA actually put out a request from artists all over the nation to submit ideas or what they thought, you know. Right, and so I thought, right. Well, and then they offered recognition and a prize, a small prize. It wasn't a lot. But I don't remember which, you know, I don't remember if my grandmother took first place or third place or what. But it's just interesting to me, thinking back on it, that they were looking for ideas. That's how I interpret it.
Yes. You remind me of a story. If you read Bill Kaysing's book, at the same time, I think NASA was asking people all over to design some sort of machines that could be used in on the moon. And years later, one guy found his drawing of a machine or something in one of NASA's books, you know, that he submitted, but he never got credit for that.
Right.
He was complaining, you know, but I think they did that. They were more like collecting ideas, you know, because they didn't know anything about it.
I think so.
Yeah. All right. So let's move on to one more thing. You told me about possibly maybe teaching in English there in Mexico. Have you been doing this? on and off?
I haven't started it, but I'm planning to start in the third week of February. So I did the reverse. When I lived in Missouri, I taught Spanish for a year in a high school Spanish class. And I think it'll be a whole lot easier to teach English than it was to teach Spanish.
Although probably now you could teach fluently because you've been living there for a while. You probably know a lot of Spanish now.
Well, I probably could. I'm fairly comfortable with my Spanish. I definitely have room to perfect it, without a doubt. But I get complimented on my Spanish frequently. Just put it that way.
Okay. Now, has learning the language changed you a little bit, like influenced your lifestyle? Like living in Japan, looking the way that people behave here has influenced me a lot, you know? They are very respectful. They never talk in the loud tone of voice or anything like that. Right. How about learning a new language, a new culture? How has it influenced you?
Well, I was raised in Mexico off and on, you know, my whole life. My mom's family was lived in northern Mexico, northern Chihuahua, and my dad's family in Arizona. So we visited back and forth all the time while I was growing up. And then I ended up coming down here to the Yucatan in 93, in February of 93, and came with my dad and two younger siblings to visit the ruins, you know, to tour all the ruins in the Yucatan Peninsula. And I met my husband down here. And so we were married 6 months later. Mm-hmm. And I've lived here in the Yucatan for off and on for the last 26 years. So it's kind of settled, the influence, I guess. The culture is definitely very different than U.S. culture. And southern Mexico is actually really, where I live anyways, the Yucatan is really different than northern Mexico, where I was raised. They have different food, different names for things. Like in northern Mexico, you can ask for a soft drink, right? But if you ask for that down here, you're going to get a package of soda crackers. Wow. So they have different names that they use for stuff, but also the food is really different. The Mayan food has a lot of different flavor combinations from your traditional Mexican food. Wow. And the Mayan people are very happy, very humble, very kind. But I think Mexicans overall are really noble, kind-hearted people. They, for the most part, they're very patriotic, and they love their, you know, their country and their culture and I think it's a beautiful thing. I personally love diversity in cultures. I think it's a beautiful thing. I don't think everybody needs to be melded into one pot of, you know, gray soup. I think we all need to have our different flavors and colors from where history is, from where we came from. And I love it. Okay. I would love to travel the world getting a taste of all of them.
Talk to your husband and who knows, make a trip to Japan. You're going to like it.
We would love to.
Yes. Come to Kyoto, very beautiful place, the ancient capital of Japan. Talk to him and start making plans.
It's a shorter flight from Hawaii. So maybe we'll have to figure out to go visit my daughters and then fly from there.
Yes. All right, Veronica, to close, I want you to tell us and recommend some Flat Earth books that have helped you and you would like to see people reading.
Flat Earth books that have helped me. Zetetic astronomy. I really liked Mark Sargent's flat earth views. That was really good. It's hard to say because I think everything that everyone contributes in flat earth, where it's a puzzle, it's a broken puzzle of earth that we're trying to piece together, all of us, and we're each getting little bits and pieces of the puzzle and trying to fit it together. And sometimes we're not getting the pieces quite right. And I think that, you know, at least this is where I stand. We've been lied to so much about everything. We have to explore all options and all possibilities. And so you look into it and you think, okay, is this true? Is this not true? But you got to at least consider what's out there before you decide, you know, there's nothing to it. And part of the reason I made the post that I did on Facebook was because I'm hoping other people will, if they read it and see it, they're going to bring out angles that, look, this isn't quite right because of this, that, or the other, something they may understand. And I think that we all help each other out. And I couldn't really put my, you know, finger on one or two flat earthers that helped me the most, because I learned so much from so many of them, you know? And at least once I got into that mode, to me, I was eating and drinking and sleeping flat earth. Every moment that I could, I was dedicating up to 10 hours a day sometimes between reading and researching and watching videos. And so I don't know. I mean, once flat earth gets in your blood, it's something that drives you. You don't want to.
Yes.
You don't want to stop.
Yes. My wife told me the same thing. You know, take it easy.
Well, I think we all reach points too where we have to take a break for a minute and clear our thoughts and whatever. But it's important. All of us contribute, I think, to helping spread the truth. And the thing is, we're all searching. We all know we've been lied to, and none of us know what the exact truth is. And there isn't, you know, we're not. There's no group that's being funded millions of or billions of dollars to research and investigate it.
Exactly.
And so as we ourselves feel like we come across truth and information, I feel like it's our duty. You know, truth is to be shared, knowledge. And that's what I don't like about secret societies, is that they are enlightened, right? They're being the enlightened ones, but they hide everything in secret, in darkness, and they don't want to share with anyone. So in the process, they're creating huge deceptions. And they feel like it's no big deal to deceive people, because if they're too stupid to search for the truth, then they deserve to be lied to, is their philosophy on it. You know, knowledge isn't supposed to just be given to people. They feel like you have to earn it in degrees and stages. So ultimately, I think the majority of high-level Freemasons understand that the world is stationary, flat, plain. There's way too much symbology that tells us that. And I think it's our duty, all of our duty, to try to bring out the inconsistencies and bring out the truth. And when we feel like we've been inspired or we've gained a new understanding by whatever we've researched, to share it with people. And so that's what I'm doing right now. I'm just about ready to publish a book myself, Flat Earth book.
Yes, yes, please.
A pragmatic approach to flat earth cosmology. So,
okay, whenever you got that book ready, let me know. We can run like a commercial on my channel, whatever. And I want to be the first one to buy from you.
Awesome. I'll let you know.
Please.
Yeah. Please. We got to get it out there. And so I'm throwing ideas around and waiting for people to and I intentionally posted my ideas in certain globe versus flat groups, because I need to understand whatever angle they're going to throw at me and why it could possibly be true or false, you know? And so I'm feeling the waters, and I don't have a scientific, you know, background. And everything that has to do with flat earth is considered fringe science, right? Mainstream science doesn't take anything to do with creationism or anything that's out of the norm, right, as anything right. but science. So it's all just fringe science, and we all get scoffed at because, you know, if you don't have a string of ABCs behind your name that prove you know something, you're someone and you know something, then you're easily dismissed. They don't care. Anyway,
but I don't care about them anyway, so you know, I'm like, I don't care about them.
So I don't expect any great reviews from Globers, and I'm sure that anybody that sticks their neck out there, you probably, your book is, your information that I have seen is excellent and great comparisons, and I'm like, how do they explain that? How do they explain these, you know, emergency landings if the earth is not flat? It doesn't make any sense. And so, but I bet you even people telling you that you're ridiculous, right? Anybody?
Yeah, sometimes, but lately I was surprised. I haven't got any attacks actually, because I made some good points there, especially chapter 15, 16, 17. I haven't got any attacks ever since. And I was kind of surprised, because I used to get more before I published the book. After I published, all the pilots who used to write to me, they stopped writing me. And I used to have them writing me a lot. So, because they can't explain some stuff, you know. Those flights
because
from
you're
Hawaii.
Making, you're,
you know,
you're bringing up
from, yeah, you know, flight from San Diego to Hawaii stops in Oakland. Makes no sense at all. How can a flight stop in Oakland for emergency landing? I mean, it makes no sense. So right. I'm open, you know. I have my email there. I have my channel. But they stopped writing me or attacking me. And I think I made a point there, you know. So I'm pretty sure you're going to make a point in the book. That's why I'm excited to see.
Yes, I hope to make quite a few points. Hopefully. And one of the main ones is this idea about a South Polar star, and being able to see it, you know, from everywhere in the Southern Hemisphere, and being able to see the Crookes constellation, you know, the Southern Cross. And everyone likes to act like you can see it all over the Southern Hemisphere, just like you can in the Northern Hemisphere. And the fact of the matter is that you cannot see it. You cannot see the Crookes constellation in Africa, Australia, or
and
South America at any time together. Never are any of those three continents able to see the Southern Cross at the same point in time. Now, I'm not talking about because, you know, they have the time differences, but going off the Greenwich Mean Time, the GTM, and doing the calculations, let's see, so from Africa, and I'm talking on the same parallel, right, on the 22 degrees south parallel, doing the time all the way across in each country. Sunset in Africa, it takes, after the sun sets in Africa, it's a full almost 8 hours before sun begins to set in Brazil.
Yeah.
And then after sun sets in Brazil, it's a full 13 and a half hours before the sun sets in Australia and New Zealand. And so there's never at any point in time that these three countries can see the Crookes constellation, the Southern Cross, at any one time. Okay. The other thing is, you never see, like in the, when you see the what do you call them? The star trail, the slow, goodness, my brain went blank. When they record in slow speed so that they can...
Yeah. The star trails.
The star trails, you know, they can video the star trails.
Right.
In the northern hemisphere, from most of it, you can see the full circumpolar star trails going right around Polaris in a full circle above the horizon, right? Well, in Australia and New Zealand, you never see the bottom third of the circle, never. Like looking at the horizon, it always appears to be about this far up, and the star trails start on the left and they go up clockwise and go down on the right. And so the Crookes constellation starts here and it ends up, starts on this horizon, it ends up going down on the other horizon and it sets. And you always see the stars travel in an arc, like a rainbow across the sky. You never see a full circle pattern of stars anywhere in the southern hemisphere. You don't see a full circle. Why is that? And they've never shown us any circumpolar star trails from Antarctica. Imagine that. Right.
Yes. You got a point. Yes.
So it's just, yeah, it's not possible. It is absolutely impossible for any country in the southern hemisphere to see the night sky at the same time. They don't do it. Judging by time, and I'm not talking about time differences, I'm talking about actual hours of time passing. Regardless of the time zone that they're in. We're talking sun up and sun down, you know, sunset, from sunset to sunset. You don't see stars before the sun sets. No. Therefore.
Yeah. Great. I can't wait to see your book. Okay. Veronica, it was really nice. I mean, I really enjoyed talking to you. I want you to come back when you got your book ready. Please come back and talk to us, talk about your book. Okay.
Okay.
Talk to your husband. Come and visit us here in Japan.
All right. It would definitely be fun. We would love that. Thank you so much for the opportunity to chat and get to know you.
Thank you. It was a blessing. It was a blessing talking to you. Thank you.
Likewise.
Bye-bye.
Have a great day.
You too. Bye-bye. When you think airplanes are flying over Bow Earth and then...
Scare in the air for passengers on board an American Airlines flight. The pilot warning everyone on board that they would be landing.
You realize that an emergency landing...
But first this morning, a Qantas A380 carrying about 400 passengers had to make an emergency landing at Perth Airport earlier this morning.
Makes more sense on the Gleason's Flat Earth map. It's in this moment that you realize...
A second emergency landing in less than 2 weeks.
That the Earth is not a spinning ball.
Last night here, we reported on that emergency landing here.
Breaking news, here is a live look at the San Francisco airport where a flight from Hawaii was forced to land because of a medical emergency involving a flight attendant.
Bogota to Frankfurt emergency land in Manchester only makes sense on a flat earth map. Hong Kong to Los Angeles, emergency landing in Alaska only makes sense on the flat earth map. Chicago to Doha, emergency landing in Moscow only makes sense on the flat earth map. Paris to Shanghai, emergency landing in Siberia only makes sense on the flat earth map. Flight routes and emergency landings, the physical properties of water, the compass, gyroscope, radars and lighthouses, the lack of curvature. All points one simple truth, that the Earth is